Look with me in Joshua chapter 24 and verses 14 and 15. And Joshua says, "Now therefore fear the Lord and serve Him in sincerity and in truth." Let me stop right there a second. Consider this. Do you fear the Lord? Say, "Well, God's loving God. He loves me and I don't have to fear Him." Oh, friend, sometimes you take God for granted. Listen, let me tell you, God is a loving God. God is a God of love. God is a God of mercy and grace and compassion. Boundless mercy, boundless grace to be found in the eyes of our loving Lord. But I'll tell you something, that doesn't change the fact that He is also holy, holy, holy. That He is righteous, and His demand of righteousness for His people has not changed. His standard of holy living, nowhere in the Bible does it say that He ever changed His mind about that. And you see, we have this westernized, kind of modernized view of God where He's just this big teddy bear, this big pushover, you know, where He loves us and He just is like a sugar daddy, just ready to just give us whatever we want. And that's simply not biblical. Now, God is God of love and God is good. And I often talk about, you've got to believe. If you're going to receive good things of God, if you're going to have faith to believe for healing, you need to come to the Lord believing that He is good and that He does want to bless you and wants good things for you. But you must not come harboring sin, you see. You must not come harboring doubts about His authority over your life and whether you have authority over your own life and whether or not you have to answer to Him. And all of these things play in. And they're playing in the minds of Israel. And Joshua, though he was a great man of war, he also was a man of God. And he understood this going on in the minds of the children of Israel. And therefore, he knows God's giving him, by the Spirit, is giving him enlightenment about what's going on in the hearts and minds of the nation that he's been leading. He's not under any delusions. And so he says, "Fear the Lord and serve Him in sincerity." Were you sincere when you worshiped the Lord in church today? Perhaps you weren't able to get there, but have you taken the time to sincerely seek Him? In sincerity and in truth. The only way you're going to have truth about your knowledge and understanding of God, the only way you're going to have truth in your worship of God, is that you know and understand Him as He is described to us in the holy book, the Bible. There's no other source of information about who God is, but first one must come to the Word of God and believe that it is the inspired, the Bible is the inspired, infallible Word of God. And from it, we learn of who God is, what His character is like, and what His expectations for you and me are. That's how we serve Him in sincerity and truth. It has to be rooted and grounded in the Word. And He said, and put away. It's amazing to me that Joshua has to say this to them after all they've been through. But he knows them. He hasn't been spying on anybody. He doesn't have anybody's tent bugged. He's not going and asking people, "Hey, what do you know about so-and-so?" You know, he doesn't have to do that. A man of God don't do that. That's just wickedness. He just knows by the word of knowledge, by the Holy Spirit of God moving on him, he knew that there was a problem among the people. And so he has to tell them, amazingly enough, in verse 14, in the middle part there, "And put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the flood," referring to the place before they crossed the River Jordan, "and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. And if it seem evil to you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve." Look here. You're free, my friend. You're free to make that choice. And Joshua here telling the children, "Hey, you're free to choose." But they had already seen what choosing anything other than God would get you. They come into this land filled with heathens, and they saw the wickedness. They saw the poverty. They saw the disease. They saw the disease in among the Egyptians in Egypt. They know all about what serving other gods will get you. And folks, we know by simply looking at the nations around us today. We know what secularism will get you. We know what globalism will get you. But we know what communism and all that nonsense gets people. All it does is spread the misery evenly. And yet we have people in our country today who still striving, fighting tooth and nail, clawing hard to have those very things. To be like the other countries around us in places throughout the world. And to have some kind of borderless world where we can all just be like each other all around the world. And of course, the whole point is just spread the misery evenly so that America doesn't stand out as a nation founded on Christianity or Christian principles, and so that America doesn't stand out as a nation that is strong because of trust in God. As our coinage says, in God we trust. It's our national motto, in God we trust. And I submit to you today, my friends, that it has been our trust in God that has got us this far. At least the trust of those of us in this country who do trust in God, I'll put it that way, and our prayers. And God has been merciful. And God has been merciful to the children of Israel thus far under Joshua's leadership. But if it seem evil unto you, in verse 15, to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve. Why would it seem evil? Well, that phrase is used a lot, generically speaking, throughout the Old Testament. Something seems evil. In other words, it's not choice. If it doesn't seem choice to you, if it doesn't seem like a good thing to do, if it doesn't seem like something you would enjoy, if it just seems hard or just plain boring to serve God, well, make up your mind. And friends, I challenge you today, make up your mind right where you're at today. Today is the day, now is the time. A clear-headed evaluation of the facts, though. And I talk about this. Now, you know, all of my belief in the Lord is in faith in His Word, and trust in Him is by faith. But there's also some very plain evidence and some very plain facts that one can take into account. And when you do, just clear your mind of the nonsense and the influence of the world and think clearly and look at reality. I would suggest that you look at it from a faith perspective, but a clear-headed evaluation of the facts will show you that the Lord Jesus alone is the only one who really identifies your need and presents the only livable solution. Who else in history? What other great religious leader, you might say, which Jesus was not a religious leader. He was the Son of God. But as far as looking at what's offered by any other solution that's offered in this world today, how do they address the real need? There's no one like Jesus who comes right out and says our problem is our sin nature. Our problem is sin, and that not only does He point out the problem, but then He offers the solution for it. Where else do you find that? Now, there are religions out there that tell you, oh, you can work your way in. You know, and through they have various, you know, you can perform the pilgrimage, or you can perform certain other rituals or so forth, or you can say certain phrases over and over again, or you can deprive yourself of certain material needs. And they all teach these things, but they all leave you empty and lost and on your way to hell. But it was Jesus who said, you're a sinner. You live a life that is guided by an innate desire to disobey God, the God who created you. But He brings a solution to that by first giving His own blood as the Lamb of God, shedding His own blood as payment and propitiation for that sin, and then rising from the dead on the third day, taking victory over that very grave which looms over each and every human being on the face of the earth, and taking that victory to heaven and sitting on the right hand of God and sending forth the Holy Spirit of God to dwell in us, by whom we are empowered and enabled and made a new creation. Through Him, we have not only the recognition of the disease, but we have the healing for it. Amen. Praise be to God who giveth us the victory through Jesus Christ. So there is no, you can choose, but ultimately no one will meet your need like Jesus will. Choose you this day whom you will serve. He says, but as for me, he says, look at this. Put away the gods, he says, and choose whom you will serve. In verse 15, and then he goes on and says, or the gods that were in that were among the Amorites in whose land you now dwell. He said, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. You know what? God needs men in this country who will take a stand as head of the household, who will lead their family spiritually, help them talk to them about the Lord, spend time with them, help them to realize, you know, that the Bible ought to be taken seriously, that it's well worth your time to study because it's the inspired, infallible Word of God, and encourage each member of our family to seek their own personal relationship with God. It's not my place to dictate to my kids or my wife how their relationship with God should go. I don't lay out an ABCs 1, 2, 3, here's how a relationship with God ought to be kind of a program for my people. And that's not my place to do that. I believe each of them should pursue God and experience God as He leads them. But first and foremost, they each one have to know, they have to know the salvation of God through the blood of Jesus Christ. They have to be saved and their sins washed away and forgiven through the blood of Jesus, and that by faith and a confession from the mouth. And I've seen that in each of their lives, and they've been baptized, and I watch them, and I know that they love the Lord. This is what the Lord expects of me. This is what this whole country needs, is men who will, like Joshua, take a stand and say, you know, you have your choice, folks, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Can you say that today? It reminds me of what happened in 1 Kings in chapter 18 and verse 21. When Elijah comes back into the land of Israel, they've had drought for so long and everything, and now the people are worshiping Baal, and there's these priests of Baal are gathered there in 1 Kings in chapter 18 and verse 21. Elijah finally just says, I've had enough of this. This is nonsense. This is pure stupidity. We've got to change. This has got to change. Somebody's got to deal with this. We've got to meet this challenge head on. And you know what? That's what we need in America. We need men who will stand up and say, that enough of the nonsense. Let's meet the challenges head on. Let's do what's right for a change. And Elijah steps up before the people and says, hey, if God is God, then worship God. But if Baal is God, then worship Baal. But make up your mind. How long, he said, will you halt between two decisions? And I hear so many believers today, they can't make up their mind whether they believe the Bible's inspired, infallible Word of God, or whether they believe it's just a good list of suggestions for how to live a moral life. They can't make up their mind whether God actually created this universe in 6 literal days, like He said, or whether there's something to this whole evolution theory, and maybe it took billions of years, and maybe it all happened in little phases and little steps, change by change, one by one, over 4.5 billion years of time. They can't make up their mind whether a person ought to live a life that's holy and dedicated to God and free from fornication, or whether it's okay to go out here and partake. You know, oh yeah, man. And they encourage their sons, get out here and meet the girls, you know, take them on dates and get in the sack first chance you get. That's manhood, you know. They can't make up their mind. They halt between, they halt. You know what it means to halt, right? There's no progress. Why? Because they're torn between two worldviews, and they're not making up their mind which one is right and which one is destructive. And that was the case with the nation of Israel when Elijah came forward. That's the case with Israel right now as Joshua stands before him and says, you've got to make up your mind whom you will serve. Choose. You have the choice. But they could look at what had happened to the nations that they in whose land they now dwelt, and they could see that serving other gods doesn't work. And we can look at the nations, America can look at the, you know, they chide Trump for being anti-globalist. And they take him to task and try to find something wrong with him every day in the media because he's anti-globalism and he's more about nationalism and putting America first. And yet, they can look at the countries around us and see that there's nothing out there better than what the founding fathers of this nation had in mind for us. A nation under God. A nation of laws that are founded upon Christian principles. It has worked and worked very well when we look at all the other nations around us. And God has delivered the nation of Israel as they, sitting here with Joshua standing before them, lecturing them on the choice that lays ahead and the days and the years that are going to confront them now. They're going to have hard times. They're going to have to work hard. And you and I are going to have to work hard. There's no doubt about it. If you're going to have any success in life, you have to dedicate yourself. You have to see where the clear path is. You know, as I've talked about here before, find out where God is working and get involved there. Seek God's will in your life. And you'll have success and work hard toward that. Be diligent. Don't fall to the right or to the left, but stay on that straight and narrow path. And this is his whole thing with the nation of Israel. Don't be halt between two decisions. But make up your mind. If God is God, then why on earth would you do anything other than give yourself wholly to Him? And the people answered. It's interesting to me how the people, as they answered Joshua, they're so quick. They're really being quick to vindicate themselves. Rather, because in my opinion, as the man of God stands before you, you should feel conviction. As the man of God stands before you and gives you the Word of God, I don't care how well you've done. There ought to be some conviction in your heart. There is in mine every time Billy Ray preaches a message. I look at my life and I know there are areas where I can do better. And I need to. And I want to. Because I want the Lord's blessing. I want to please Him in my life. You ought to want to please Him if you know Him. It's one thing about when you know someone who's really great, then you want to be in good with them, don't you? That's how God is. I mean, I know Him, and I know how great He really is. And so, yeah, I want to please Him. I want Him to be pleased with my life and to be always ready to bless and to heal and to provide and to lead and to guide and to give illumination and to give revelation and to give knowledge. All of these things and wisdom which only God can do these things. Well, you must experience Him for yourself. The children of Israel had experienced so much. And yet now, here they are. Instead of saying, yeah, Joshua, let's have prayer. Let's have some sacrifice. Let's, whatever the Lord would have us to do right now to sanctify ourselves before Him, let's do it. But no, here's what they said in verse 16. And the people answered and said, God forbid that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For the Lord our God, He it is that brought us up and our fathers out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage, and which did those great signs in our sight and preserved us in all the way wherein we went and among all the people through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out from before us all the people, even the Amorites which dwelt in the land. Therefore will we also serve the Lord, for He is our God. Very, very strong words of just, self-confidence right there. And we need to have confidence, let me say. Confidence. But it needs to be kingdom confidence. It needs to be confidence in our God. Now, the things they say, when you first read, you might think, yeah, well, that's good. They realized that it was God that led them through. That is good. They realized it was God that brought them out of Egypt. They realized it was God that brought them across the River Jordan. They realized it was God that worked great signs and wonders. They realized it was God that drove out the enemies before them. They realized it's God that's blessed them with the land that they can now begin to dwell in. They realize, and you should, that's basic, folks. That's not advanced theology by any means. You understand? You know, we oftentimes so quick pat ourselves on the back. Well, I know who I trust. I know why I've been saved. I'm so glad I know that I've been saved. And we're so quick. And I'm not condemning anyone for this. But we're too quick to pat ourselves on the back when none of that is our doing. You know what I'm saying? We need to realize how we depend on Him and how we fall short of His will, and that without His help. And see, this is the thing. They needed to recognize that if God didn't help them, if they didn't make a specific and conscious effort to submit to the will of God, they knew that they would fail. They should have known this, and this should have been their confession, as well as confessing all that God had already done for them. But we need to go into the deepest part of what our need really is. And like I pointed out before, Jesus pointed out what our need is. We're sinners, and we need salvation. We need the Lord. Well, they knew they needed the Lord, but they had this self-will involved in there. And that's why Joshua answers them rather harshly. You know, we read those three passages, those three verses, and we think, well, that's a good answer. But look at how Joshua answers them, because he knows that this is all rooted in self-righteousness. This is what Paul wrote about in the New Testament. Paul wrote and said, you know, the reason the Jews missed the righteousness of God was because they were busily going about trying to establish their own righteousness. And as a result, they ended up losing out. And Joshua says to him in verse 19. Read with me. And Joshua said unto the people, you cannot serve the Lord, for He is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions nor your sins. Whoa. What? Wait, whoa. Wait a minute. Joshua, what are you saying? God, I thought we could serve the Lord. No, I can't serve the Lord. He's holy. He doesn't need anything from me. I want to serve Him, and I need Him to use me in service for Him. But I'll never serve Him without He doesn't empower me to do so, without He doesn't cleanse me by His precious blood on that cross of Calvary. If He didn't cleanse me, if He didn't make me fit, if He didn't sanctify me, if He didn't justify me, and if He didn't put His Holy Spirit in me, I can't serve Him. And if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Bible says God will not hear my prayer. And if I want to live my life with one foot in the world and one foot in the kingdom of God, I will stumble. I cannot serve the Lord. That's what Joshua was saying to him. Look, I already pointed out how that he had a word of knowledge from the Spirit of God. That they had idols. That they had things going on in their lives that they needed to get rid of. And he told them, put all that stuff away. Those were the mistakes your fathers made. They all died in the wilderness. You don't want to go down that road. God won't put up with it. See, I told you earlier, we have this westernized, modernized idea of God. There's this big pushover, a sugar daddy who's just going to give us and love us and give us what we want. And that's not the whole picture. God is good and He wants good things for you, but He is holy, holy, holy. And He will not turn a blind eye and a deaf ear to wickedness and sin in our lives. And He will not condone it. He will hold us accountable. And we will miss out on His blessing because of our lack of faith. So Joshua warns them very plainly. He will not forgive your transgressions nor your sins if you forsake the Lord and serve strange gods. Forget about it. Well, if you're serving the world and then going to church on Sunday and paying your tithe and trying to worship, do you think that God's real impressed with your worship? Do you think that the children of Israel here could have their false idols in their tent at home and then go down to the tabernacle and offer a lamb and that God would receive that offering? That's what Joshua's saying. He's not going to receive your sin offerings if you're in the meanwhile harboring unconfessed, unrepentant sin. That principle about God has not changed. A lot of folks think they got God fooled because they prayed themselves a little prayer and they think they've locked God in on some kind of a legal technicality. Folks, God is real. He's not a religion. You better get past that. You understand? Did you hear what I just said? I believe that was straight from the Lord. God is real. He's not a religion. Understand that about God. You're dealing with a real, omnipotent, holy person. He sees and knows everything. And His standard of righteousness is very, very high. It was only answered through the cross of Calvary. That's for sure. But you and I, the Bible says we will stand before the Lord to give an account. The Bible says that we will stand before the judgment seat of Christ to give account for the things that we've done in the body and for every idle word that is spoken. So there's no fooling God. And in this life, right now, where are you experiencing a lack of blessing? Where are you experiencing a lack of power? Think hard and long on these questions, folks. You simply cannot keep one foot in the world and one foot in heaven. You cannot serve two masters, our Lord sternly warned us in several places throughout the Gospels. And Joshua warns these people that they will get destroyed if they try to play both sides of this game. Because it is not a game. And there is no other character in history, no other thing in this whole world which addresses our deepest and greatest need and brings us the solution the way that Jesus does. People say, well, God knows my heart. Well, He loves me anyway. But He requires commitment. Because the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 14, without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Think about these things. Why then is it a struggle? Turn with me on over, just flip the page, just cross the street here as it were, to Judges in chapter 2 and verses 7 through 13. And you can see where after Joshua died, It says, now, the people, in verse 7 of Judges chapter 2, it says, the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders that outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great works of the Lord that he did for Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died, being 110 years old. And they buried him in the border of his inheritance in Timnath-Heres, in the Mount of Ephraim, on the north side of the hill Gash. And also, all that generation... Now get this, all that generation, that means those people who were contemporaries of Joshua, the same people who were in that same age group, that same generation, people who grew up with Joshua, had seen through the wilderness, seen after crossing Jordan, seen all the works of God and experienced firsthand the power and the love of God. They all died. Also, all that generation, verse 10, were gathered unto their fathers, and there arose another generation after them, which knew not the Lord, nor yet the works which he had done for Israel. And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and served Balaam. And they forsook the Lord God of their fathers, which brought them out of the land of Egypt, and followed other gods, of the gods of the people that were round about them. Get this? They forgot the Lord. This new generation, much like young generations that we see today, baby boomers and on up, they didn't have to see firsthand the value of the freedom, the value of a constitution based on Christian principles and what it means for your life and how it ensures your prosperity and health and your safety. This generation now, since the baby boomers on up, they haven't really seen and understood the value of it. They missed World War I, World War II. And I'm afraid our grandparents in many instances failed to really teach us, to really drive these things home. And as a result, we have people today that are doing exactly what these folks here in Israel did. It says, they followed other gods of the people that were round about them. And today our leaders look at nations around and say, we need to be like them? Really? Isn't that ridiculous? And you would think that a people, you know that their parents, these children of Israel here, you know that their parents told them all that had happened. You know that they had to have spent time reading the law of Moses and talking about how that they had fought those battles and God had given them victory over the heathen in the land. But no, they forget anyway because they haven't experienced it firsthand. So often, that is our downfall. So often we have to go through struggles we have to do without so often in order to realize and appreciate what we have. After Joshua died, they lacked the kind of leadership they needed, a firm hand. That's how Joshua led the people, with a firm hand. He led on the basis of the Word of God, very important. And once the remaining elders who knew him and lived by his example also died off, the next generation quickly forgot about the Lord. And I think we see this beginning to creep in chapter 1. Turn over there to chapter 1. You can see in verse 19, you can see right here where this doubt in God first started, I believe. This is just a little clue that the Scriptures give us. As these children of Israel began to spread out and continue to take more of the land of Israel, as Joshua had instructed them before his death, they still had more of the land of Israel to take. The promised land, rather, to take and to dwell in it. And so as they began to spread, it says here in verse 19, they had victories and stuff, but here in verse 19 it says, and the Lord was with Judah, and he drove out the inhabitants of the mountain, but could not drive out the inhabitants of the valley because they had chariots of iron. Huh. I didn't know God was such a weakling that chariots of iron could beat him. Did you? Really? You think that God is not stronger than iron chariots? What is it in your life that you have difficulty believing God for? Think about these things. I can just see, you know, it wasn't that God wasn't stronger than chariots. Chariots are nothing. I mean, he, you know, look at Pharaoh's chariots. They all went to the bottom of the sea. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. He's a deliverer. He's a conqueror. God is the mightiest warrior that ever existed. When he unveils his mighty arm, he fights for his people, and there is nothing but victory against any force. It does not matter. But when we disbelieve, when we doubt, children of Israel saw, they got a really well-equipped, they got technology. Ooh, they got iron chariots. Uh-oh, run. There'll be no victory that way. Maybe a doctor brought you the bad report like the spies in the land. Come back and say, well, it's bad. You're just not going to make it, man, unless we pump you full of this here drug and dope you up real good and maybe even radiate you a little bit. Eh? Then you might have a 1% chance. Well, that's the best you can do, though. So, you know, fork over the cash and let's get on with it, right? And that's what they do. And you see that. Do you forget? Excuse me. My God is greater. The name of Jesus is the name above every name. What is that name that haunts you, that afflicts you, that stands before you? Is the name iron chariots? Is the name cancer? Is the name pain? Is it arthritis? Whatever it may be, the name of Jesus is greater. But we so often lose sight. Listen, we're no different from these children of Israel in this way. We lose sight of God when we sit. We're just like Peter. You know, I was talking to my wife this week. I said, you know, a lot of our faith, a lot of times, is based in our own naivety. You ever think about that? When our faith ought to be based on the power of God, instead, sometimes we have faith just because we don't know any better. That's true. That sounds a little difficult to swallow, but hear me out. Take, for example, Peter. All right? And he sees Jesus walking on the water, and he says, Lord, if it's you, bid me to come. And the Lord says, well, come on. Peter stepped out on the water. But it was when he got out there and saw the waves, what happened? When he saw the waves boisterous and the wind blowing, the Bible says he began to sink. He began to sink when he found out what he had gotten himself into. You see, he stepped out there not really knowing, not really thinking about what he'd gotten into. And at that point, we're often like that. There's a certain level of naivety about us, or where we're just plain ignorant, and we don't know what we're getting into. That should not make any difference, folks. But our faith, if it is to be strong, if it is to be victorious, if we are to win every battle in the name of Jesus, then our faith has to be based not on what we don't know, but on what we do know. That we do know who He is. That He has given us victory over death, hell, and the grave. That by His stripes I am healed. That He took upon Him all of my sin, all of my burden, my poverty, my sickness, my need, all of it. He spread forth His mighty arms on that cross of Calvary, and He suffered in my place, and He was laid in the grave in my place, and He rose again on the third day and is seated. And the Bible says He's seated on the right hand of the Father, and that I am seated with Him as part of His body, where He is the head, and that He has placed under His feet. And if I am part of His body, then it's under my feet, and He has placed under my feet all principality and power and given us victory. That's faith based on what I know. Won't you surrender your heart to Him today, right where you're at? I've run out of time here on the Voice of Hope broadcast. This is Brother Brent Adams, and I thank you again for tuning in. Pray for us and tune in again next week. God willing, we'll be here with a new message God's laid on our heart. All right. Thank you. God bless you, and goodbye.